Thank you. She wants half a lettuce. So I said, okay, well then I'm going to have to go and to me saying, yes, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn you. And the Lord himself draws us with loving kindness. He's not talking behind your back. He's got your back. He's the one that is defending you on every corner. The Lord your God goes before you. He says, and I have loved you with an everlasting love and drawn you with loving kindness. And this is the season to return to God again, to be restored in the mighty name of Jesus. There are two things that I see in this verse that I would like to discuss with you this afternoon. And firstly, I see the unspeakable, unquenchable love of God in this verse. The love of God that makes a covenant of grace with man. By the blood of Jesus, that is the kind of love that we are talking about in this verse. The blood that was shed on Calvary, I have loved you with that everlasting love. You were loved and fashioned by God. Before God came down to earth and rolled Adam into clay and breathed life into Adam, God loved you even before that. Do you know that God loved you even before the world was rolled in his hands, or even before he threw the stars and created them in the sky? God was there before he spun the mighty orbits into place, before the planets were formed. God says he knew you by name, he knows the name of every star, and you are more special than every star. God knew you before the world began. He has predestined you. He knew the journey of your life. And he has loved you with an everlasting love. And in Ephesians 1:4-5, even as he chose us before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him, in love he predestined us for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ according to the will of his purpose. That is the everlasting love. In Isaiah 54 and verse 10, we see more of the immeasurable blessing and the love of God. For the mountains may depart and the hills may be removed, but my loving kindness, my steadfast love, shall not depart from you, nor my covenant of peace shall not be removed from your life. God has made a covenant of peace with you. And if you know anything about Bible studies and Old Testament covenants, you know that it's always about blood. A covenant is about blood. He has made a covenant with you through the blood of Jesus. And in the Old Testament, they used the blood of bulls and goats. And Pastor, you didn't know that I was preaching this. I didn't know you were preaching what you preached this morning, but it's like we shared notes. It's about the Spirit of the Lord. But do you know that it's not about the blood of bulls and goats? Those bulls and goats were sacrificed in the Old Testament to merely cover sin, not to wash sin away. It was just covered that the face of the Lord will turn away from the sin and see the sacrifice. But the precious blood of Jesus removes your sin. As far as the east is from the west, he takes your sin and he buries it in the sea of forgetfulness. And it's as close as a prayer, this covenant of love that God has with us. What an immovable blessing. But it is for us to accept it. If I give you a gift and you never open it or receive it, it's not about the giver, it's about the receiver. And we need to receive everything that God has for us. He loves us so very much. And the second part of the verse is his unmistakable manifestations of kindness. Like I was talking about the man in the grocery store having to wobble and try and be kind suddenly. age to come, that he may show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us. There is a richness in the kindness of God. The kindness of God is even attached to the blessings of God. He's the most kindest, if there's a word for kindest, I don't know. He's the kindest father you could ever have. And if you can imagine a really kind dad just nurturing a child and wanting the best for that child, do you know that God's love and kindness way outweighs that? And I see those dads that are always trying to check ways how to bless their children. And God wants you to be blessed. But the most important blessing he wants you to have beyond riches is salvation. That is the most valuable, incorruptible gift that we have been given. In Romans chapter 2 and verse 4, Romans chapter 2 and verse 4, or do you despise the riches of his goodness, forbearance, and long-suffering, knowing not that the goodness of God leads you to repentance? So if we are not long-suffering and we aren't doing things that are good, we are literally despising the riches of God that God wants to give into our lives. Kindness is one of the fruits of the Spirit. And as we lock into God and we want to know God's heart, like that song says, the heart of worship, those fruits of the Spirit will start manifesting naturally in your life. You won't have to force it like the guy in the grocery store. It will naturally become somebody who wants to do kind things, even for other people, so that you may lead them to Jesus himself. Hallelujah. So I don't want you all to be like the grocery store man. You're going to be more like Jesus. And this afternoon, I want you to take your communion and just hold your biscuit in your hand as I go through this next portion. As you go through this next portion of this meeting with me, I want you to look at the biscuit that is in your hand this afternoon. The one that we're using here, I mean, you can use anything at home. You can use bread, you can use a Mari biscuit, you can use anything. But the one that we're using here this afternoon is called matzah. Matzah, you can say matzah. Matzah, if you look at the matzah, it's a very dry biscuit with little burnt edges on it. And there's a reason for that, because matzah is used by the Jewish people in the Passover meals that they share together. And the reason for it is they look at this biscuit and they remember the dry desert that was burnt and parched, and that how God took them through the wilderness into the promised land. And when I look at this biscuit, I see the scorched body of the Lord Jesus Christ that was whipped on the cross and has taken us through a wilderness of sin into an abundant place and a place of blessing. The Passover meal was first also used when they put the blood on the door, when there was Passover, when the angel of death passed over. So the matzah was used to remember them going through the wilderness, but the blood was put on the door so that the angel of death would pass over. And if our hearts are right with God, when we die, do you know the angel of death will pass over? Because death, let me give you an explanation this afternoon. Death isn't just when your body dies, no. Death is separation from God. For me to die is Christ. So when you die, this corruption will put on incorruption. I will become an incorruptible being if I am in Christ. Do you know that you are an incorruptible being? You are going to live forever. It depends where you're going to stay. And death means to be separated from God. But life is to know him. He has come that we would have life, and life more abundantly. So we find, if you look in the chapters, in Luke chapter 22, when Jesus shared the Last Supper with his disciples, he conveyed the power of he conveyed a very amazing message here. Passover that day became communion. It was the day the name changed from Passover to communion. And this is what happens. When Jesus shared the Last Supper with his disciples, he conveyed the power of the Passover to Holy Communion. No longer would we have to sacrifice the lamb for the atonement of sins, because the lamb that was slain that day sat at the table. There wasn't a lamb that day. Jesus was going to be the Lamb of God. And that is why, if you're a new Christian and you're wondering, why do these crazy people call Jesus a lamb? This is why. He is the Lamb of God that was slain from the foundations of the world when he had you in mind. So as you get this teaching here this afternoon, nowhere in the account of the Passover meal did they mention the lamb when they sat in Luke 22, because at the Last Supper, the lamb was not on the table, he was sitting at the table. When came the day of the unleavened bread, which was Passover lamb, he had to be sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John saying, "Go and make preparations for us to eat the Passover." And if you look at Luke 22, I'm going to go from verse 14 there. "Where do you want us to prepare it?" the disciples asked Jesus. They asked, he replied, "As you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to the house that he enters and say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is the guest room? Where may I eat Passover with my disciples?'" We often think about Palm Sunday, how the donkey was loose, the master has need of it. But here, the master had need of a table and a place to have the communion. And here he comes into a complete stranger's house, and there's a table all set. "He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished. Make preparations there." They left and found things just as Jesus had told them. So they prepared Passover. When the hour had come, and Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, he said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat again of this until the fulfillment of the kingdom of God." After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, "Take this, divide it among yourselves, for I tell you, I will not drink from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took the bread, and he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So Lord Jesus, we take this bread in our hands and we hold it and we remember you. We remember the sacrifice that you gave for us on the cross of Calvary. We remember that you became the Passover lamb for us. And as we eat, Lord, we want to thank you that you are the one that forgives us for any sin in our lives, that we would examine our hearts if there's any wicked way in us, that you would forgive us. And as we partake together, thank you that you forgive us with your unfailing, immeasurable love and kindness. In the mighty name of Jesus, let us partake together. Applying the blood of Jesus to the heart, to your very soul, if you would take it with the right attitude. So as we partake of this blood, know that the blood of Jesus stands against the demons of hell, that no evil force is allowed near where the blood is, because the blood of Jesus represents a life that was lived without sin. And so, Father God, as we partake of this cup tonight, we remember the new covenant in your blood. Father God, I thank you that nothing can wash away our sins but the blood of Jesus. And as we partake together in unity, we want to thank you for your blood. In the mighty name of Jesus, let us partake together. I make a declaration over you as the redeemed of the Lord, who has partaken of the very body and the blood of the Lord. I decree and declare in the mighty name of Jesus that at the cross you were free from every bondage of sin and death. And in the name of Jesus, if there is sickness on your body, that sickness will go now in the mighty name of Jesus. By the stripes of Jesus, you are healed. Sickness and disease has no part of the child of God, that you would have the abundant life. You are delivered from every addiction, every oppressing spirit in the name of Jesus. Every spirit of suicide is not welcome anywhere near you, because the precious blood of Jesus is applied to your heart. The captivities of your life have ended from today. You are free in the mighty name of Jesus. And even in this place, as we lift our hands, that our hands would be clean, that we would have clean hearts, O God, and clean hands to serve you. And Father God, I thank you that we can always come to this fountain of blood. Thank you for the redemption of sin. And Lord God, we lift our hands up to the sky and we say out loud that Jesus Christ is Lord. Praise you, Jesus. I'm going to call.
I've got a song that the angels cannot sing. It's a song of praise to Jesus Christ the King. Oh, he saved my precious soul. From sin he made me whole. And that is why I now can shout and sing. Oh, I will praise the Lord for what he's done for me. I will praise the Lord throughout eternity. I've got a song that the angels cannot sing. It's a song of praise to Jesus Christ the King. When I look back to what I might have been, I see someone bound to die in deadly sin. But God's mercy reached to me, from sin he lifted me, and now I know that I belong to him. Oh, I will praise the Lord for what he's done for me. I will praise the Lord throughout eternity. I've got a song that the angels cannot sing. It's a song of praise to Jesus Christ the King. One day soon we'll see him face to face. See the one they took and hung up in our place. Hear him say to us, well done, you're my daughter and my son. You've been faithful and you've run this earthly race. Oh, I will praise the Lord for what he's done for me. I will praise the Lord throughout eternity. I've got a song that the angels cannot sing. It's a song of praise to Jesus Christ the King. It's a song of praise to Jesus Christ the King.